Let's see. We should take that box tomorrow too. Oh, hi. Good evening, folks. Hey, thanks for joining in again. I'm your host and producer, Jon Showers. What we got going on this weekend is extravaganza time. So you gotta kind of excuse me with what I got going on with the boxes here. I just picked up a box or two, and I'm getting some boxes of stuff ready to take out to the sale this weekend. And man, we got a great show in store for you guys tonight. For those of you just joining in, I want to welcome you to our show. We are the Pennsylvania Pickers, and I've been doing this since I'm about 12. And this is our version of American Pickers, except we're not out for your money. What we're out to do is kind of educate you on what some of this stuff is. And well, let's put it this way. If you think you can make $1 million at it, send me a dollar, I'll send you a copy on how to do that. I haven't made that yet, but anyway, I want to welcome you to the show. And let me put some of this stuff down here. What I'm holding here is, this is one of the hot things right now, the Hot Wheels type stuff, the red lines and that. I came across this Hot Wheels lunchbox and the thermos. Man, this was a good lucky find too, because this thing here, I got it for, well, I can't tell you what I got the price I paid for it, but these things are going for about $350, down to about $250 in crappy condition with no thermos on them. But let me put it down here. We got stuff spread out all over the place here. You know, I got some kind of things going on, like I said, trying to get ready for the sale. I'm glad you guys joined me tonight. So, I want to welcome everybody. And for those of you joining in for the first time, you can pick your friends, you can pick your nose, but you better pick the best seat in the house. Because for the next half hour, here at BCTV, we're coming at you with the best in family entertainment. And what this is an educational entertainment. And the fact that what we're doing is a different topic of sort each month. And this is episode number 14, as I'm saying. And if you go on BCTV page on YouTube, you'll see that, man, this list is growing of this. And this is a hometown thing. You know, this is what it's all about. This Americana. And, you know, America is founded upon this type of stuff. Now, this industry is that a lot of people thought, you know, by watching what's on syndicate TV that, well, they're being misled a little bit in some ways they're not. What we're doing here is we're throwing the whole present truth at you. You know, yeah, some of this stuff is worth crazy money, but there's so much of it out there that the hard part is finding that person that's willing to pay that. And, you know, in the meantime, the high and the fun for me, and I got to tell you, I'm not on anything. I'm on life. This is what the high is. You never know what you're going to find. And every month, every week, every day I do this, I never know what's going to happen next, what I'm going to end up finding with this stuff. And it's never ending. That's the thing, is that it's an absolute never-ending industry that if you look at it to the fact that you're not going to try to get rich from it and you're not going to try to make $1 million and be greedy, this is a fun way to both spend your free time and to learn history. Every one of these items, there's nobody that can live without them. So by this point in our lives, a lot of what this is bringing back memories, you know, from our childhood, things that our grandparents had or whatever, but there's also history involved in it and the companies that made that. And that's the part that's being lost with what's going on with this New World Order type thing. And it's not really a conspiracy theory. There's a lot of truth to this. I'm not going to get into politics, but, you know, what they're getting into now is a throwaway society, and this stuff here was meant to last. We're meant to last. We're not throwaway people. But yet some of the New World people, they think that people are supposed to be throwaways. It's crazy times that we're in, but this is why, you know what, you got to make use of every minute and have a pleasurable time with. I want to give a few shout-outs to a few people. Number one, you see here, Speedway, start your day. I got to give a shout-out to these guys, Vanessa, Chris, Gina, she's a hometown favorite here. I want to thank you guys for keeping me going with the coffee from out there. I mean, they call me in the middle of what I do here with this, and always got to have that coffee to get you kind of going. Also, a shout-out to Renier's Antique Market. Now, let me explain to you what this extravaganza is all about. We're blessed with something here in Berks County, Lancaster, and kind of Dirt Farmer part of Lebanon County. And in fact, nothing against them, but you know, they don't have as much as what Lancaster and Berks County has. What we're blessed with here is the largest concentration of antique shops on the east coast of the United States, next to some place down here in Georgia. I don't know, I've never been down to it, but I've been wanting to search it out one time, but I don't know, I get lost back in the woods of Georgia. I get a little scared sometimes. I don't want to go down there at night, but we're blessed with this. There's basically an antique shop of some sort every 75 feet. Now, that means something. What that means is we save stuff in this region, and we make use of it. We repurpose things. You know, that's what we're taught to do is, you know, being thrifty Americans. And in this region, it was so hard hit during the depressed areas of the 30s and the 40s that this is what's been instituted into my generation and the kids after my generation. After that, I don't know what happened. They got lost in a crack of the sidewalk or something. But, you know, in any case, you know, they turn into a throwaway type society, whereas we're taught to make use of this stuff and, you know, have it going over and over. For myself, it's reliving my childhood in a way as well. you know, things like buying a model at Art's Hobbies down on 10th Street. And can you believe this, Johan? I just recently came across this. Somebody was giving me a couple bucks to get rid of some stuff. It was basically covering my gas. This is a $100, $150 to $190 model. So if you find a Johan out there, this is some money. Now back to what I was saying. This extravaganza, what this is three times a year. What we have is a period that goes from Thursday till Monday. Some places, they started on this past Monday. So starting tomorrow, what we have is Antique Extravaganza. And what that is starting with like Reiners in Kutztown, they'll have early buyers. Before all this crap started, what we were having was, like the guys that I have friends with that are from Japan, they were coming here to buy kitchenware that was made when it was metal, mid-50s type stuff, and chip cans. Charlie Chip Cans. Another shout out to Jimmy Peterson over there in Japan. Thanks for serving our country, buddy. And, you know, these Charlie Chip Cans, I mean, tell me what they get from them. And Sturgis one, and I was like, this is incredible. You know, why would something like that that's here sells for 20 bucks over there go for $200, I'm thinking. The Disney movies, you know, that are the VHS tapes from, you know, when I was down here, my experience with the rat, as we called it, was, I don't know if they were really made by accident at some point. People were spending their whole paychecks on them. Some of these were 50 grand a piece. The only places I've found that they've sold is in Japan. And I got two tubs on them. You find out where I can sell them, I'll split it with you. Because you know what? It's, again, I mean, you could have something worth $50,000, but who's going to pay that money? That's the hard part. Auction business, I got to tell you, right now, it's a buyer's market. It's not the time you want to be taking stuff to auction. Only people making out of the auction houses. And I'm not against that, but you're not going to get the top dollar for the things at the auctions right now. Half of this stuff here, I've got peanuts in this stuff. Maybe $2, $3 for whole tables. Then you go through things and you go, wow, look at this. You know, but what's happening with extravaganza is that this is the period, three times a year we would do this, that it was in the springtime when everybody would be coming out after all winter of buying up things or finding stuff. And they save it for that first good spring day to bring it out. And then in the beginning of summer, around Father's Day, right after Father's Day, what we call the summer extravaganza. Now, this was our baby. This was the one that, as a dealer, this is make it or break it. This is one, as most of these dealers, these people, they travel during this. They live out of a car. You know, they're not grifters, per se. It's a way of life. And it's a unique way of life because it's traveling to America to different flea markets, a different town each weekend, and the people that they meet and things. But it's also an unscrupulous crowd that's also associated with it. So you have good and bad in all this. But what it is for our region, and I reached out to try to get, and yesterday, and I thought, well, I'll have to bring her on maybe another show and see if she wants to maybe have something she collects. Margot de la Rouge, I want to give a shout out to her from what was the Berks Chamber of Commerce that's now Greater Americana for this region. You know, for us to promote this region, when I saw back in February that our area, Aunt Redinger's, was voted number 4 in the antique and collectible industry for places to go and to visit. I mean, folks, I was flabbergasted. I mean, this throws me back to the days of the outlet centers, you know, where, you know, we were having buses by the dozens coming in this region. The money flowing into our economy here was phenomenal. Put people to work. I mean, it was upbeat all the way around. I worked in a restaurant called Dempsey's. Shout out to Terry Prince, everybody from there. It lines out the door wrapped around the building. I mean, what it did for our region is that you don't want to be a bedroom community. You want people that are going to come here to spend their money and enjoy what they're doing at the same time. And it's a family-type industry, so it's not a thug thing related with it. You don't have to worry about getting killed or whatever. And you know what I mean? It's hometown America stuff. Now, this industry, I mean, the way it's jumped off with this extravaganza, this was one of the best things we had going. The third one that we were doing was in the fall, which we call the homecoming. That's the last one of the year. Now, that's when you're going to try to find the deals. Now, since this situation, I'm going to call it, that started happening a little over a year ago, and I'll leave it at that because we're neutral. We're not going to get into any politics here. But if you got a brain, you can figure things out. What this did was it just put it into the toilet. Everybody said, oh, we're doing great. This thing, well, it really hasn't. I mean, it's starting to come back now slowly and surely, but it's been a buyer's market. This is the time you invest your money in this stuff. But what it also turned it into is a desperation crowd. Can't blame the people. I'm the same way. I'm looking to buy something like this, a $350 helmet maybe from World War I, you know, for $3. The fact of the matter is, you don't go to a place that's like a mall where the people know that everything they got is worth what it's worth. You go to somebody on the outside, but this is what we said in the beginning, the coyote people. What they're looking for is to prey upon people that don't know the values of some of this stuff. And they'll offer you $2-3 and do it with a smile. Let me show you one of these things, big example. This is something, man, that everybody out there watching probably knows of. Okay, guys, just shoot in on this. These are no longer just mashed potato balls, okay? These are one of the items that were made for the housewife starting about the mid to late 40s. Knowing the troops are coming home with the house ladies, you know, they're gonna be making mashed potatoes. So they're not just mashed potato balls anymore. These were made by the Pyrex company. So this was the first time that this type of glassware could be put in an oven. And next thing you know, they started doing different patterns on it. Now, this is what they call snowflake garland, okay? I want to shout out to the people that I got these from this past weekend. They came in and went, looked at the cellies. I saw some of these and went, wow. Now, the one that caught my eye, keep the camera on here, that's Crazy Daisy. That's another one. That's from the 70s. Was this, the primary colors. These are the ones that started it all. Now, in four of these, you may think it's buck, 50, 75 cents at a yard sale. Wrong. I paid these people 10 bucks for this. This is probably worth probably about 26 to 30. And I'll tell you why. Well, actually, maybe about $5 less than that. It's got the R symbol underneath of it. Now, what they did with Pyrex is they numbered these. The R symbol, what they also did is, that's to indicate the years that these followed after the first series. Now, that first series in the 40s, the 401 to 404s, you would have had 4 blue, 4 yellow, 4 red, 4 green. What you see out there for sale, one this size, one yellow one, one red one, one green one. That was not the actual set. It was each of the colors. Now, you got to have a little bit of money to be doing that back then, or guap, as they'd say, you know. But what ended up happening is these things jumped in value. Now, before this situation started a year ago, I had sold a set of primaries. I think we'd gotten about $280, $240 for it. Now, I had wrapped up in it. What I do is I build sets out of these. Now, these are one of the things that I like to collect. This is an interesting one more down here at the table. If you guys remember on the show with the shrunken head, guys, I got to share, guys and gals, I got to share this with you. Yeah, this thing's real. People are questioning it. The first day I had this hanging out at Ringer's, and this guy goes, "That's for sale." 10 minutes after we opened, I thought, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Since that time, I think we're up to about 20, 24 people that tell me they have other heads at home. Now, what I looked into with these were available. Yes, it was a real head. Doesn't have a skull on it. It's not illegal. They were done in like the 30s to the 50s, which is when John Steuben's uncle got his missionary down in Ecuador. These tribes were, they sold them as souvenirs. You know, just like you go to like Gatorland and you bought like a fake alligator, or you bought an alligator foot. Now, just because you have it today doesn't mean, oh my God, it upsets me. Throw it away, burn it. What's it gonna do to you? Well, what's happening is one of the stitches in the eye is coming up, and the one, see, it's snarling. Can you see that from there, camera guy? Can you imagine that? It didn't do that when he gave it to me on the show. What that means is there's evil in the air out there. That's a bad sign. So, someone, that's a crazy thing, you know? This is a neat little piece I come across. It's a bottle opener from Bell Telephone. It's got Berks County roots. They used to be down on Fifth Street. And found a box of a bunch of this John F. Kennedy stuff that... He might be coming back, Junior. He's out there. We're in baseball season, guys. This is one little hot thing people are after now, the baseball bats. I got the short ones. I don't have a Chris Comstock. I'm going to give a shout out to him. He's my neighbor. You want to go see him on the real baseball stuff. Man, I'll tell you, this guy knows it all about anything with sports. And man, I'm learning off of Chris as a friend and neighbor. And man, I couldn't believe how much of this stuff is really still out there. And I wouldn't even know it if I came across this all, because we weren't really keen on the baseball thing. I do got to share something with you guys that I did find, speaking of that. I want to give a shout out there to Norm Showers. He's from up north, no relation to me, and no relation to storming over him in the city. Okay, I'm going to bring this up close to you guys to see this a bit better. This is a hometown hero. This is Lenny Moore. Now, some may know about Lenny Moore in the Reading area, some may not. Let me share with you what I can tell you about Lenny Moore. My uncle, Dick Nyman, Richard Nyman, he went to Northeast with this fella, went to Reading High with him. Also Penn State, and then on to Baltimore Colts. And this guy was from Reading. Man, when I seen this card over at Norm Shower's place, I was like, oh my God, guy, what do you want on that? And he's like, for you, John, 30 bucks. And I was like, you know what, it ain't about that. This is something I would keep because it's got a past history associated to it, you know? And like I was saying to you, that's one of the things that's kind of an important thing. Came across here, a boarding pass from the Titanic. Man, you might want to look into that story. That's a pretty interesting one as well. And found some locomotive history associated with, now this is Piney River, Virginia. But we were building these things in Reading. And on the Burks one site on Facebook, they were asking the buildings on 6th Street, and that's where these things were built. So this is stuff that's out there, it's in our area, it's disappearing, but I gotta show this one to you guys. I used to have a friend named John Fundiga. His brother Craig Fundiga, we used to play music like the monkeys in the backyard. Came across this Eagles album, and you guys out there, this is the big thing everybody's after. The Rubber Soul type album that there's a misprint that is worth several hundred dollars. It's hard to find it though. Where's the Eagles one? Oh, here. Craig Fundiga. I ended up going to work playing music with these guys. And he's from Reading, Pennsylvania. Shout out to you, buddy. These are from some of the ones I had as a teenager. These are money. Now, this is one that, you know, I'm going to do an actual show on records, but my record people are kind of shy and want to come out here and do this. But I'm going to put this out there to the viewers. You come across these, or if you have these, don't let people think or fool you that they're not worth anything, especially if they're earlier editions. Now, if they have scratches and that, that's going to determine a little bit. But when you got color like that on that photo album, or these, my buddy up north in Massachusetts, oh, yeah. I want to wish a happy birthday to a Connor Scantlin. This is a Rolling Stones Tattoo You little t-shirt. It's coming out to you, buddy. And we here at Burks Cable, we know about you, Connor. You're important to us. You're going to be fighting them cyborgs in the future. You know, once that Terminator comes, he's going to need you, buddy. But we'll get on that later. But these are the first and the second edition. Album 1 and Album 2 of Boston. When I met Tom Schultz at their studios up there. He's since passed on. But you see the artwork that was involved in that. What we've got is a trend going back into vinyl. And that stuff from that era especially is worth money. Our new generation of what people are collecting, and I got to touch on this even though some say, oh, it's no good. It's like the original Pokemon cards. Now I found these, and the Konami, the early ones, Yu-Gi-Oh! Or whatever. This person goes, oh, that's got dark side associated. I said, look, I don't care if it's dark side, gray side. If it's legal, it ain't hurting women, kids, or animals. Whatever it's worth, it resells for, that's different. But when I was a kid, you want to talk about offended, we had these things called Waggy Packs. And they really offended you. Well, you might see if I can get a closer. See, like, look at this one. They're mocking things. Here we got Fink. Canada Wet. You know, you try to do stuff like this today, oh my God, they'd have a fit. But these Waggy Packs, shout out to Brian here at Rainier's, he's got like whole sheets of these that are worth, I think, like $350, maybe even more. But when I was a kid, this is the kind of thing where we offended everybody. But you know what? We took it in good humor. That's all it was. You know, don't lose sleep over it, as we'd say back then. But, you know, it's quite an industry, like I said, with this stuff. The way that what you can find and what's coming out of it. I want to zoom in over here where the cat is. Got to show this one here. We're going to do a show coming up here in the future with, I want to do, Jack Ravesnyder, a local guy, wants to do one at his museum. He's got it's private. But over here, this is off of Scotty Palmer's top fuel dragster when he blew up. As you can see, people collect these types of things. So I want to do a show on, and I'm going to say about August, where we're going to touch on the cars maybe. Maybe September when NHRA comes back into Reading. And shout out to Terry McMillan out there. You know, Terry, hey, easy come, easy go. You always get a sponsor, man. You know, the thing of it is he had fun doing it. And when we do the show then, I think we're going to touch on like the Lesney Hot or the Lesney Matchbox, the different things that they have in values on those, as well as the Redline Hot Wheels. But you see, these are some of the things that people are looking for at these markets. Now, with this extravaganza thing, the way this goes about is that Thursday will be like the start at Redinger's. That's the official, like, big hoopla. There's really not a big master of ceremonies or nothing like that. It just starts happening. People will be there probably setting up as we're speaking now. People coming in from out of town, all over the country. Shups Grove, I thought I had some of, where'd they go, the pamphlets? From, oh, here we go. I want to give a shout out to these people because this is important to our area. This is Shups Grove, and, you know, I'm fair with everybody. You know, we're not promoting one particular company. Shups Grove is down just off of 222 in Adamstown region, owned by Marilyn Gaiman, and she's got the most fantastic place. You've got this flea market setting underneath the trees, and get ice cream cone, walk around there, had a little deli, man. That year I was working at deli there, well, I had a fantastic time. I had a line out the door right there on the building waves at Dempsey's. But, you know, I'd help Marilyn out with doing some work. We'd set up an encampment there, as people had known, as part of my collection and things. And, You know, what she does is, and here I try to see if we got some of the pictures on it. It's more of a, here's the one we're showing the people in the, like the midway area. If we can zoom in on that. See how it is there? It's a little bit different. It's under the trees, it's out in the open. It's not the hustle and bustle of like, you know, big open field and the blazing sun and that, but bad thing is when bad weather comes, if you know this area, stick around, the weather changes in 5 minutes. It's bad weather. But she does a different theme each weekend, like we're doing here, a different theme each month. And she's got an interesting thing on her cover for this time. This is something, again, this type of things you can find out there. A leg. It's a leg. This is an artificial leg from the Civil War. Can you believe that? Again, this is antiquities. There's no harm, no foul in it. You don't need no war reparations. That was the bad thing is when you lost a leg in the Civil War, they paid you by the pound. However much a poundage of that leg weighed, that's what you got paid. You didn't get paid no set settlement like they do today. No $3,300, $3,800. You got paid by the pound. Imagine that. You lose a leg, you pay by like three. Man, I ain't got a whole lot of pounds on my leg. I get like 59 cents. But anyway, see the things that you can find out there, and that's half the fun in this, as I said. That's the high end. Oh man, I got to show you this, guys. I found this thing. It was all rusted up. Couldn't tell what it was. And as I said, this is one of the things I like collecting is from Reading. You got to see this. This is from our industrial era here. This is the Great Iron Foundry Company, Reading, Pennsylvania. And if you can tell by this, it's coming back of brass. Let me show you the back. This was cast number 275. Now, I haven't found a whole lot of history on that, but my guess is this is probably a salesman's or somebody in the main office, but this place is no longer in existence. And this is this is Reading in the background. Look at that, look, this is one factory. Imagine a whole city of these. You look at some of these pictures from that area and you look at us now and you go, what happened? You know, where did it all go? But that's kind of incredible. I've been polishing this like, you know, as I do at nighttime. I don't really watch a lot of TV except this show. This is the best one to watch. But, you know, I said, man, I gotta show this to these guys. There's another cool one. This one still works. This goes to show, this is a souvenir from Las Vegas. Late 1940s. And what this is watch this. It's a roulette wheel. So you take gambling home and still gamble at home. And what did they do? Sell advice. That's the whole name of the game. Gotta share this with you guys. The kitchenware, as we had said, from that period, these fellows I knew from Japan, they were coming here for things like this. This is made by Kitchen Pick, was the name of this company. They were aluminum. First TV dinners made out of aluminum, this thickness. And if anybody out there has one, the Vietnam Museum, I'm trying to put together for Berks County, that is going to house my collection. I need one of those for that. But that's going to be on a separate show. I'm going to try to get my friend Mark Boyce to come on this. But can you see this? They were also number two. Now, this says it was made by Miro. So you had a company that was underneath of a company. And this is what, again, founded America, this type of thing. People are after this type of stuff out there, but for different purposes. They want it for the money. What I want it for is to preserve the history of it. And we do got to share this. This is not about color. This is not about anything but Americans. When they say, where do you live? I say America. They say, who are you? I say American. The fact of the matter is, it doesn't matter what color you are, what country you came from. This is the place that you came to put away that horrible way of life maybe you left, or the persecution or whatever, to come to a free country so that you would have the ability to do this. Now, in socialist countries and in communist countries, you can't do that. I'm not going to get into political again, but, you know, this is what it's all about, America and family. You know? We're winding down our show. One of the things I remember as a child, this was kind of neat. I found this in the box, like I said, that I picked up, was whenever you went anywhere, I should put some of the pennants, maybe next one, you would see these inside of, like, the cash registers. Now, we recently lost an icon of Roadside America, but they were known for this type of stuff. And these things, when you were a kid, man, wherever you went, you had to get one. Now, you see, what they did was, each of these old historical buildings, some of these are monuments that they tore down. This was a whole book full of those. And the period of this is incredible. 1956. So you see, America went from a statue that, just a statue. A statue to nothing, anybody. And now they're tearing them down. Come on, man. We're Americans, man. I'm not supposed to do that. But, hey, who am I to say anything? I'm not here to judge anybody. Another interesting show we're going to be bringing up to you, folks. I think we're going to do this one. If we don't do the racing one until August, we move back to September. We'll do this one in August. The phones. Now, we're winding down over a few minutes. I've seen the phone industry going from Bell Telephone as a kid with the rotary phone and a party line to the cell phones of today. The cell phones of today are not just a phone, it's a little computer. And what it is people are going to guard down with these. Recently, last week, my phone was hacked, and I can't get into Facebook. They changed that. Got a phone number to two things I don't even want to mention about. One's local, that I don't even know what that's about. But, you know, don't let your guard down with these phones by depending your whole life on it and by putting all your business out there on them. I made that mistake, and it cost me dearly. And I don't like to be standing here telling you folks about this, but on this phone show, what I'm going to do is we're going to try to bring Ken Steigerwalt out that repairs clocks. He's a clock expert. And maybe his family, Val, maybe would have come in for him and be the spokesperson and, you know, explain to you how things like the time and clocks to these have changed so much, and yet it's an important fact of our life. And be wary of what's going on with these newer phones. Remember, where's it made? Who's the person you're speaking to when you call them up? You can't understand? And what is it called? The track phone. There is somebody up there that you got to be careful with. So I want to thank you guys for joining us on today's show. I tried to cover some of this as best as I could, and I do want to say that this new stuff that's being collected, like the Xbox and the games, Nintendos and all that, that's another whole show in itself. And this is why I said, for what we've got going on with this, this is what I'm seeing ahead in the future for this. You know, and even though things are starting to get back to normal a little bit, I'm telling you what, this is a never-ending type thing. I'm here for 441 more years to bring you a good time and to do well for mankind. And you know, with that, I'm going to have the best I can to try to share with you guys. And I want to thank you again for joining us here at BCTV. Do got to say, we're going to be moving here very shortly into a new facility. My program director, John, was telling me yesterday, and I'm excited about that as well. It's an historical area. Oh, man, I got some stuff I can throw out there for that one. But I want to thank you all for joining in with us here at the Pennsylvania Pickers. Once again, you can pick your friends, you can pick your nose, but you better pick the best seat in the house, and you better pick the best people to put in your life so you don't have a bad time, you enjoy the life the best that you can. And with that being said, I want to tell you folks, it's my pleasure to be here with you. Oh, one little tidbit. The statue. This guy is turning into an intriguing thing that we're not finding information on. Moon-eyed Indians is what it's coming close to. This may be a show in itself. So with that, folks, if you have any information, just call into the station. They'll get back in touch with me. And I want to thank you all for joining us, folks. And we'll see you again next month. Don't forget, the Pennsylvania Pickers. We're there every week, and we're there to help you be the best that we can. Thank you, folks, and good night.